Good evening, and welcome back to Booked for the Night. I'm Melissa Phillips, and tonight I'm reading the final chapters of Old Yeller by Fred Gibson. Enjoy. Chapter 13. I was like Mama. I didn't think Elizabeth Searcy would be any help around the place. She was just too little and too skinny. I figured she'd just be an extra bother for Mama. But we were wrong. Just like Bud Searcy said, she was a big help. She could tote water from the spring. She could feed the chickens, pack in wood, cook cornbread, wash dishes, wash little Arliss, and sometimes even change the prickly pear poultice on my leg. She didn't have to be told, either. She was right there on hand all the time, just looking for something to do. She was a lot better about it than I ever was. She wasn't as big, and she couldn't do as much as I could, but she was more willing. She didn't even back off when Mama hooked Jumper to the cart and headed for the field to gather in the corn. That was a job I always hated. It was hot work, and the corn shucks made my skin itch and sting till sometimes I'd wake up at night scratching like I'd stumbled into a patch of bull nettles. But it didn't seem to bother Lisbeth. In fact, it looked like she and Mama and little Arliss had a real good time gathering corn. I'd see them drive past the cabin, all three of them sitting on top of a cartload of corn. They would be laughing and talking and having such a romping big time, playing with a speckled pup, that before long I half wished I was able to gather corn too. In a way, it sort of hurt my pride for a little old girl like Lisbeth to come in and take over my jobs. Papa had left me to look after things, but now I was laid up and here was a girl handling my work about as good as I could. Still, she couldn't get out and mark hogs or kill meat or swing a chopping axe. Before they were finished gathering corn, however, we were faced with a trouble a whole lot too big for any of us to handle. The first hint of it came when the spot heifer failed to show up one evening at milking time. Mama had come in too late from the corn gathering to go look for her before dark, and the next morning she didn't need to. Spot came up by herself, or rather, she came past the house. I heard her first. The swelling in my leg was about gone down. I was weak as a rain-chilled chicken, but most of the hurting had stopped. I was able to sit up in bed a lot and take notice of things. I heard a cow coming toward the house. She was bawling like cows do when they've lost a calf or when their bags are stretched too tight with milk. I recognized Spot's voice. Spot's calf recognized it too. It had stood hungry in the pen all night, and now it was nearly crazy for a bait of milk. I could hear it blatting and racing around in the cow pen, so starved it could hardly wait. I called to Mama. "Mama," I said, "you better go let old Spot into her calf. I hear her coming." "That pesky Spot," I heard her say impatiently. "I don't know what's got into her, staying out all night like that and letting her half go hungry." I heard Mama calling to Spot as she went out to the cow pen. A little later, I heard Spot beller like a fighting bull, then Mama's voice rising high and sharp. Then here came Mama running into the cabin, calling for Lisbeth to hurry and bring in little Arliss. There was a scare in Mama's voice. I sat up in bed as Lisbeth came running in, dragging little Arliss after her. Mama slammed the door shut, then turned to me. "Spot made fight at me," she said. "I can't understand it. It was like I was some varmint she'd never seen before." Mama turned and opened the door a crack. She looked out, then threw the door wide open and stood staring toward the cow pen. "Why, look at her now," she said. "She's not paying one bit of attention to her calf. She's just going on past that cow pen like her calf wasn't there. She's acting as crazy as if she'd got hold of a bait of pea vine." There was a little pea vine that grew wild all over the hills during wet winters and bloomed pale lavender in the spring. Cattle and horses could eat it, mixed with grass, and get fat on it, but sometimes when they got too big a bait of it alone, it poisoned them. Generally, they'd stumble around with a blind staggers for a while, then gradually get well. Sometimes, though, the pea vine killed them. I sat there for a moment, listening to Spot. She was bawling again like when I first heard her, but now she was heading off into the brush again, leaving her calf to starve. I wondered where she'd gotten enough pea vine to hurt her. "But Mama," I said, "she couldn't have eaten pea vine. The pea vine is all dead and gone this time of year." Mama turned and looked at me, then looked away. "I know," she said. "That's what's got me so worried." I thought of what Burn Sanderson had told me about animals that didn't act right. I said, "Cows don't ever get hydrophobia, do they?" I saw Lisbeth start at the word. She started at me with big, solemn eyes. "I don't know," Mama said. "I've seen dogs with it, but I've never heard of a cow brute having it. I just don't know." In the next few days, while Old Yeller and I healed fast, we all worried and watched. All day and all night, Spot kept right on doing what she did from the start. She walked and she bawled. She walked mostly in a wide circle that brought her pretty close to the house about twice a day, and then carried her so far out into the hills that we could just barely hear her. She walked with her head down. She walked slower, and her bawling got weaker as she got weaker, but she never stopped walking and bawling. When the bull came, he was worse, and a lot more dangerous. He came 2 or 3 days later. I was sitting out under the dog run at the time. I'd hobbled out to sit in a chair beside Old Yeller, where I could scratch him under his chewed-off ear. That's where he liked to be scratched best. Mama was in the kitchen, cooking dinner. Lisbeth and little Arliss had gone off to the creek below the spring to play with the pup and to fish for catfish. I could see them running and laughing along the bank, chasing after grasshoppers for bait. Then I heard this moaning sound and turned to watch a bull come out of the brush. He was the roan bull, the one that had the droopy horn Chongo had dumped into the Mexican cart the day of the fight. But he didn't walk like any bull I'd ever seen before. He walked with his head hung low and wobbling. He reeled and staggered like he couldn't see where he was going. He walked head-on into a mesquite tree like he wasn't there, and fell to his knees when he hit it. He scrambled to his feet and came on, grunting and staggering and moaning, heading toward the spring. Right then, for the first time since we'd brought him home, Old Yeller came up off his cowhide bed. He'd been lying there beside me, paying no attention to sight or sound of the bull. Then, I guess, the wind must have shifted and brought him the bull's scent, and evidently that scent told him for certain what I was only beginning to suspect. He rose with a savage growl. He moved out toward the bull, so trembly weak that he could hardly stand. His loose lips were lifted in an ugly snarl, baring his white fangs. His hackles stood up in a ragged ridge along the back of his neck and shoulders. Watching him, I felt a prickling at the back of my own neck. I'd seen him act like that before, but only when there was the greatest danger, never while just facing a bull. Suddenly, I knew that Mama and I had been fooling ourselves. Up till now, we'd been putting off facing up to facts. We'd kept hoping that the heifer Spot would get over whatever was wrong with her. Mama and Lisbeth had kept Spot's calf from starving by letting it suck another cow. They had to tie the cow's hind legs together to keep her from kicking the calf off. But they'd kept it alive, hoping Spot would get well and come back to it. Now, I knew that Spot wouldn't get well, and this bull wouldn't either. I knew they were both deathly sick with hydrophobia. Old Yeller had scented that sickness in this bull, and somehow sensed how fearfully dangerous it was. I thought of Lisbeth and little Arliss down past the spring. I came out of my chair, calling for Mama. "Mama," I said, "bring me my gun, Mama." Mama came hurrying to the door. "What is it, Travis?" she wanted to know. "That bull," I said, pointing. "He's mad with hydrophobia, and he's headed straight for Lisbeth and little Arliss." Mama took one look and said, "Oh, my Lord!" in almost a whisper. She didn't wait to get me my gun or anything else. She just tore out for the creek, hollering for Lisbeth and little Arliss to run, to climb a tree, to do anything to get away from the bull. I called after her, telling her to wait, to give me a chance to shoot the bull. I don't guess she ever heard me, but the bull heard her. He tried to turn on her, stumbled, and went to his knees. Then he was back on his feet again as Mama went flying past. He charged straight for her. He'd have gotten her, too, only the sickness had his legs too wobbly. This time when he fell, he rooted his nose into the ground and just lay there, moaning, too weak even to try to get up again. By this time, Old Yeller was there, baying the bull, keeping out of his reach, but ready to eat him alive if he ever came to his feet again. I didn't wait to see more. I went and got my gun. I hobbled down to where I couldn't miss and shot the roan bull between the eyes. Chapter 14. We couldn't leave the dead bull to lie there that close to the cabin. In a few days, the scent of rotting flesh would drive us out. Also, the carcass lay too close to the spring. Mama was afraid it would foul up our drinking water. "We'll have to try to drag it further from the cabin and burn it," she said. "Burn it?" I said in surprise. "Why can't we just leave it for the buzzards and varmints to clean up?" "Because that might spread the sickness," Mama said. "If the varmints eat it, then they might get the sickness too." Mama went to put the harness on Jumper. I sent Lisbeth to bring me a rope. I doubled the rope and tied it in a loop around the bull's horns. Mama brought Jumper, who snorted and shied away at the sight of the dead animal. Jumper had smelled deer blood plenty of times, so I guess it was the size of the bull that scared him. Or maybe, like Yeller, Jumper could scent the dead bull's sickness. I had to talk mean and threaten him with a club before we could get him close enough for Mama to hook the single tree over the loop of rope I'd tied around the bull's horns. Then the weight of the bull was too much for him. Jumper couldn't drag it. He leaned into his collar and dug in with his hoofs. He grunted and strained. He pulled till I saw the big muscles of his haunches flatten and start quivering. But the best he could do was slide the bull carcass along the ground for about a foot before he gave up. I knew he wasn't throwing off. Jumper was a full lot of pesky, aggravating mule tricks, but when you called on him to move a load, he'd move it or bust something. I called on him again. I drove him at a different angle from the load, hoping he'd have better luck. He didn't. He threw everything he had into the collar, and all he did was pop a link out of his right trace chain. The flying link whistled past my ear with the speed of a bullet. It would have killed me just as dead as if it had hit me. Well, that was it. There was no moving the dead bull now. We could patch up that broken trace for pulling an ordinary load, but it would never be strong enough to pull this one, even if Jumper was. I looked at Mama. She shook her head. "I guess there's nothing we can do but burn it here," she said. "But it's going to take a sight of wood gathering." It did, too. We'd lived there long enough to use up all the dead wood close to the cabin. Now, Mama and Lisbeth had to go way out into the brush for it. I got a piece of rawhide string and patched up the trace chain, and Mama and Lisbeth used Jumper to drag up big dead logs. I helped them pile the logs on top of the bull. We piled them up till we had the carcass completely covered, then set fire to them. In a little bit, the fire was roaring. Sheets of hot flame shot high into the air. The heat and the stench of burnt hair and scorching hide drove us back. It was the biggest fire I'd ever seen. I thought there was fire enough there to burn three bulls, but when it began to die down a couple of hours later, the bull carcass wasn't half burnt up. Mama and Lisbeth went back to dragging up more wood. It took 2 days and nights to burn up that bull. We worked all day long each day, with Mama and Lisbeth dragging up the wood and me feeding the stinking fire. Then at night, we could hardly sleep. This was because of the howling and snarling and fighting of the wolves lured to the place by the scent of the roasting meat. The wolves didn't get at any of it. They were too afraid of the hot fire. But that didn't keep them from gathering for miles around and making the nights hideous with their howlings and snarlings. And all night long, both nights, old Yeller crippled back and forth between the fire and the cabin, baying savagely, warning the wolves to keep away. Both nights I lay there, watching the eyes of the shifting wolves glow like live mesquite coals in the firelight, and listening to the weak moaning ball of old spots still traveling in a circle. I lay there, feeling shivery with a fearful dread that brought up pictures in my mind of Bud Searcy's uncle. I sure did wish Papa would come home. As soon as the job of burning the bull was over, Mama told us we had to do the same for the spot heifer. That was all Mama said about it. But I could tell by the look in her eyes how much she hated to give up. She'd had great hopes for Spots making us a real milk cow, especially after old Yeller had gentled her so fast, but that was all gone now. Mama looked tired and more worried than I think I'd ever seen her. I guess she couldn't help thinking what I was thinking, that if hydrophobia had sickened one of our cows, it might just get them all. "I'll do the shooting," I told her. "But I'm going to follow her out a ways from the house to do it, closer to some wood." "How about your leg?" Mama asked. "That leg's getting all right," I told her. "Think it'll do it some good to be walked on." Well, try to kill her on bare ground, Mama cautioned. As dry as it is now, we'll be running the risk of setting the woods afire if there's much old grass around the place. I waited till Spot circled past the cabin again, then took my gun and followed her, keeping a safe distance behind. By now, Spot was so sick and starved I could hardly stand to look at her. She didn't look like a cow. She looked more like the skeleton of one. She was just skin and bones. She was so weak that she stumbled as she walked. Half a dozen times she went to her knees, and each time I'd think she'd taken her last step. But she'd always get up and go on again and keep bawling. I kept waiting for her to cross a bare patch of ground where it would be safe to build a fire. She didn't, and I couldn't drive her, of course. She was too crazy mad to be driven anywhere. I was afraid to mess with her. She might be like the bull. If I ever let her know I was anywhere about, she might go on the fight. I guess she was a mile from the cabin before I saw that she was about to cross a dry, sandy wash, something like the one where Yeller and I'd got mixed up with the wild hogs. That would be a good place, I knew. It was pretty far for us to have to come to burn her, but there was plenty of dry wood around. And if I could drop her out there in that wide, sandy wash, there'd be no danger of a fire getting away from us. I hurried around and got ahead of her. I hid behind a turkey pear bush on the far side of the wash. But as sick and blind as she was, I think I could have stood out in the broad open without her ever seeing me. I waited till she came stumbling across the sandy bed of the wash, then fired, dropping her in the middle of it. I'd used up more of my strength than I knew, following Spot so far from the cabin. By the time I got back, I was dead beat. The sweat was pouring off me, and I was trembling all over. Mama took one look at me and told me to get to bed. "We'll go start the burning," she said. "You stay on that leg any longer and it'll start swelling again." I didn't argue. I knew I was too weak and tired to take another walk that far without rest. So I told Mama where to find Spot and told her to leave little Arliss with me and watched her and Lisbeth head out, both mounted on Jumper. Mama was carrying a panful of live coals to start the fire with. At the last minute, Yeller got up off his cowhide. He stood watching them a minute, like he was trying to make up his mind about something. Then he went trotting after them. He was still thin and rough-looking and crippling pretty badly in one leg, but I figured he knew better than I did whether or not he was able to travel. I didn't call him back. As it turned out, it's a good thing I didn't. Only, afterward, I wished a thousand times that I could have had some way of looking ahead to what was going to happen. Then I would have done everything I could to keep all of them from going. With little Arliss to look after, I sure didn't mean to drop off to sleep. But I did and slept till sundown, when suddenly I jerked awake, feeling guilty about leaving him alone so long. I needn't have worried. Little Arliss was right out there in the yard, playing with a speckled pup. They had themselves a game going. Arliss was racing around the cabin, dragging a short piece of frayed rope. The pup was chasing the rope. Now and then he'd get close enough to pounce on it. Then he'd let out a growl and set teeth into it and try to shake it and hang on at the same time. Generally, he got jerked off his feet and turned a couple of somersets, but that didn't seem to bother him. The next time Arliss came racing past, the pup would tie into the rope again. I wondered if he wouldn't get some of his baby teeth jerked out at such rough play, but guessed it wouldn't matter. He'd soon be shedding them anyhow. I wondered, too, what was keeping Mama and Lisbeth so long. Then I thought how far it was to where the dead cow lay, and how long it would take just for the two of them to drag up enough wood to get a fire started, and figured they'd be lucky if they got back before dark. I went off to the spring after a bucket of fresh water, and wondered when Papa would come back. Mama had said a couple of days ago that it was about that time, and I hoped so. For one thing, I could hardly wait to see what sort of horse Papa was going to bring me. But mainly, this hydrophobia plague had me scared. I'd handled things pretty well until that came along. Of course, I'd gotten a pretty bad hog cut, but that could have happened to anybody, even a grown man. And I was about to get well of that. But if the sickness got more of our cattle, I wouldn't know what to do. Chapter 15. It wasn't until dark came that I really began to get uneasy about Mama and Lisbeth. Then I could hardly stand it because they hadn't come home. I knew in my own mind why they hadn't. It had been late when they'd started out. They'd had a good long piece to go, and even with wood handy, it took considerable time to drag up enough for the size fire they needed. And I couldn't think of any real danger to them. They weren't far enough from the cabin to be lost, and if they were, Jumper knew the way home. Also, Jumper was gentle. There wasn't much chance that he'd scare and throw them off. On top of all that, they had Old Yeller along. Old Yeller might be pretty weak and crippled yet, but he'd protect them from just about anything that might come their way. Still, I was uneasy. I couldn't help having the feeling that something was wrong. I'd have gone to see about them if it hadn't been for little Arliss. It was past his supper time. He was getting hungry and sleepy and fussy. I took him and the speckled pup inside the kitchen and lit a candle. I settled them on the floor and gave them each a bowl of sweet milk into which I crumbled cold cornbread. In a little bit, both were eating out of the same bowl. Little Arliss knew better than that, and I ought to have paddled him for doing it. But I didn't. I didn't say a word. I was too worried. I just about made up my mind to put little Arliss and the pup to bed and go look for Mama and Lisbeth when I heard a sound that took me to the door in a hurry. It was a sound of dogs fighting. The sound came from way out there in the dark, but the minute I stepped outside, I could tell that the fight was moving toward the cabin. Also, I recognized the voice of Old Yeller. It was the sort of raging yell he let out when he was in a fight to the finish. It was the same ravaged roaring and snarling and squalling that he'd done the day he fought the killer hogs off me. The sound of it chilled my blood. I stood, rooted to the ground, trying to think what it could be, what I ought to do. Then I heard Jumper snorting keenly and Mama calling in a frightened voice, "Travis! Travis! Make a light, son, and get your gun! Hurry!" I came alive then. I hollered back at her to let her know that I had heard. I ran back into the cabin and got my gun. I couldn't think at first what would make the sort of light I needed, then recollected a clump of bear grass that Mama recently grubbed out, where she wanted to start a new fall garden. Bear grass has an oily sap that makes it burn bright and fierce for a long time. A pile of it burning would make a big light. I ran and snatched up four bunches of the half-dried bear grass. The sharp ends of the stiff blades stabbed and stung my arms and chest as I grabbed them up, but I had no time to bother about that. I ran and dumped the bunches in a pile on the bare ground outside the yard fence, then hurried to bring a live coal from the fireplace to start them burning. I fanned fast with my hat. The bare grass blades started smoking, giving off their foul smell. A little flame started, flickered, and wavered for a moment, then bloomed suddenly and leaped high with a roar. I jumped back, gun held ready, and caught my first glimpse of the screaming, howling battle that came wheeling into the circle of light. It was Old Yeller, all right, tangled with some animal as big and as savage as he was. Mama called from outside the light's rim, "Careful, son, and take close aim. It's a big loafer wolf, gone mad." My heart nearly quit on me. There weren't many of the gray loafer wolves in our part of the country, but I knew about them. They were big and savage enough to hamstring a horse or drag down a full-grown cow. And here was Old Yeller, weak and crippled, trying to fight a mad one. I brought up my gun, then held fire while I hollered at Mama. "Y'all get in the cabin," I yelled. "I'm scared to shoot till I know you're out of the line of fire." I heard Mama whacking Jumper with a stick to make him go. I heard Jumper snort and the clatter of his hoofs as he went galloping in a wide circle to come up behind the cabin. But even after Mama called from the door behind me, I still couldn't fire, not without taking a chance on killing Old Yeller. I waited, my nerves on edge, while Old Yeller and the big wolf fought there in the firelight, whirling and leaping and snarling and slashing, their bared fangs gleaming white, their eyes burning green in the half-light. Then they went down in a tumbling roll that stopped with the big wolf on top, his huge jaws shut tight on Yeller's throat. That was my chance, and one that I'd better make good. As weak as Old Yeller was, he'd never break that throat hold. There, in the wavering light, I couldn't get a true bead on the wolf. I couldn't see my sights well enough. All I could do was guess aim and hope for a hit. I squeezed the trigger. The gun stock slammed back against my shoulder, and such a long streak of fire sprouted from the gun barrel that it blinded me for a second. I couldn't see a thing. Then I realized that all the growling and snarling had hushed. A second later, I was running toward the two still gray forms lying side by side. For a second, I just knew that I'd killed Old Yeller, too. Then, about the time I bent over him, he heaved a big sort of sigh and struggled up to start licking my hands and wagging that stub tail. I was so relieved that it seemed like all the strength went out of me. I slumped to the ground and was sitting there shivering when Mama came and sat down beside me. She put one arm across my shoulders and held it there while she told me what had happened. Like I'd figured, it had taken her and Lisbeth till dark to get the wood dragged up and the fire to going around the dead cow. Then they'd mounted Old Jumper and headed for home. They'd been without water all this time and were thirsty. When they came to the crossing on Birdsong Creek, they dismounted to get a drink. And while they were lying down drinking, the wolf came. He was right on them before they knew it. Mama happened to look up and see the dark hulk of him come bounding toward them across the little clearing. He was snarling as he came, and Mama just barely had time to come to her feet and grab up a dead china berry pole before he sprang. She whacked him hard across the head, knocking him to the ground. Then Old Yeller was there, tying into him. Mama and Lisbeth got back on Jumper and tore out for the house. Right after them came the wolf, like he had his mind fixed on catching them and nothing else. But Old Yeller fought him too hard and too fast. Yeller wasn't big and strong enough to stop him, but he kept him slowed down and fought away from Jumper and Mama and Lisbeth. "He had to have been mad, son," Mama wound up. "You know that no wolf in his right senses would have acted that way. Not even a big loafer wolf." "Yes'm," I said, "and it's sure a good thing that Old Yeller was along to fight him off." I shuddered at the thought of what could have happened without Old Yeller. Mama waited a little bit, then said in a quiet voice, "It was a good thing for us, son, but it wasn't good for Old Yeller." The way she said that gave me a cold feeling in the pit of my stomach. I sat up straighter. "What do you mean?" I said, "Old Yeller's all right. He's maybe chewed up some, but he can't be hurt bad. See, he's done trotting off toward the house." Then it hit me what Mama was getting at. All my insides froze. I couldn't get my breath. I jumped to my feet, wild with hurt and scare. "But Mama," I cried out, "Old Yeller's just saved your life. He saved my life. He saved little Arliss's life. We can't..." Mama got up and put her arm around my shoulders again. "I know, son," she said, "but he's been bitten by a mad wolf." I started off into the blackness of the night while my mind wheeled and darted this way and that, like a scared rat trying to find its way out of a trap. "But Mama," I said, "we don't know for certain. We could wait and see. We could tie him or shut him up in the corn crib or someplace till we know for sure." Mama broke down and went to crying then. She put her head on my shoulder and held me so tight that she nearly choked off my breath. "We can't take a chance, son," she sobbed. "It would be you or me or little Arliss or Lisbeth next. I'll shoot him if you can't, but either way, we've got to do it. We just can't take the chance." It came clear to me then that Mama was right. We couldn't take the risk. And from everything I had heard, I knew that there was very little chance of Old Yeller's escaping the sickness. It was going to kill something inside me to do it, but I knew then that I had to shoot my big Yeller dog. Once I knew for sure I had to do it, I don't think I really felt anything. I was just numb all over, like a dead man walking. Quickly, I left Mama and went to stand in the light of the burning bear grass. I reloaded my gun and called Old Yeller back from the house. I stuck the muzzle of the gun against his head and pulled the trigger. Chapter 16. Days went by, and I couldn't seem to get over it. I couldn't eat, I couldn't sleep, I couldn't cry. I was all empty inside, but hurting worse than I'd ever hurt in my life. Hurting with a sickness there didn't seem to be any cure for. Thinking every minute of my big Yeller dog, how we'd worked together and romped together, how we'd fought the she-bear off little Arliss, how we'd saved me from the killer hogs, how we'd fought the mad wolf off Mama and Lisbeth. Thinking that after all this, I'd had to shoot him the same as I'd done the roan bull and the spot heifer. Mama tried to talk to me about it, and I let her, but But while everything she said made sense, it didn't do a thing to that dead feeling I had. Lisbeth talked to me. She didn't say much. She was too shy. But she pointed out that I had another dog, the speckled pup. "He's part of Old Yeller," she said, "and he was the best one of the bunch." But that didn't help any either. The speckled pup might be part of Old Yeller, but he wasn't Old Yeller. He hadn't saved all our lives and then been shot down like he was nothing. Then one night it clouded up and rained till daylight. That seemed to wash away the hydrophobia plague. At least, pretty soon afterward, it died out completely. But we didn't know that then. What seemed important to us about the rain was that the next morning after it fell, Papa came riding home through the mud. The long ride to Kansas and back had Papa drawn down till he was thin and knotty as a fence rail. But he had money in his pockets, a big shouting laugh for everybody, and a saddle horse for me. The horse was a cat-steppin' blue roan with a black mane and tail. Papa put me on him the first thing and made me gallopin' in the clearing around the house. The roan had all the pride and fire any grown man would want in his best horse, yet was as gentle as a pet. "Now, isn't he a dandy?" Papa asked. I said, "Yes, sir," and knew that Papa was right and that I ought to be proud and thankful. But I wasn't. I didn't feel one way or another about that horse. Papa saw something was wrong. I saw him look a question at Mama and saw Mama shake her head. Then late that evening, just before supper, he called me off down to the spring where we sat and he talked. "Your Mama told me about the dog," he said. I said, "Yes, sir," but didn't add anything. "That was rough," he said. "That was as rough a thing as ever I heard tell of a happening to a boy. And I'm mighty proud to learn how my boy stood up to it. You couldn't ask any more of a grown man." He stopped for a minute. He picked up some little pebbles and thumped them into the water, scattering a bunch of hairy-legged water bugs. The bugs darted across the water in all directions. "Now the thing to do," he went on, "is to try to forget it and go on being a man." "How?" I asked. "How can you forget a thing like that?" He studied me for a moment, then shook his head. "I guess I don't quite mean that," he said. "It's not a thing you can forget. I don't guess it's a thing that you ought to forget. What I mean is, things like that happen. They may seem mighty cruel and unfair, but that's how life is a part of the time." "But that isn't the only way life is. A part of the time it's mighty good. And a man can't afford to waste all the good parts worrying about the bad parts. That makes it all bad. You understand?" "Yes, sir," I said, and I did understand, only it still didn't do me any good. I still felt just as dead and empty. That went on for a week or better, I guess, before a thing happened that brought me alive again. It was right at dinner time. Papa had sent me out to the lot to feed Jumper and the horses. I just started back when I heard a commotion in the house. I heard Mama's voice lifted high and sharp. "Why, you thieving little whelp!" she cried out. Then I heard a shrieking yelp, and out the kitchen door came the speckled pup with a big chunk of cornbread clutched in his mouth. He raced around the house, running with his tail clamped. He was yelling and squalling like somebody was beating him to death, and that still didn't keep him from hanging onto that piece of cornbread that he'd stolen from Mama. Inside the house, I heard little Arliss. He was fighting and screaming his head off at Mama for hitting his dog, and above it all, I could hear Papa's roaring laughter. Right then, I began to feel better. Sight of that little old pup tearing out for the brush of that piece of cornbread seemed to loosen something inside me. I felt better all day. I went back and rode my horse and enjoyed it. I rode way off out into the brush, not going anywhere especially, just riding and looking and beginning to feel proud of owning a real horse of my own. Then along about sundown, I rode down into Birdsong Creek headed for the house. Up at the spring, I heard a splashing and hollering. I looked ahead. Sure enough, it was little Arliss. He was stripped naked and romping in our drinking water again. And right in there, romping with him, was that bread-stealing speckled pup. I started to holler at them. I started to say, "Arliss, you get that nasty pup out of our drinking water." Then I didn't. Instead, I went to laughing. I sat there and laughed till I cried. when all the time I knew that I ought to go beat them to a frazzle for messing up our drinking water. When finally I couldn't laugh and cry another bit, I rode on up to the lot and turned my horse in. Tomorrow, I thought, I'll take Arliss and that pup out for a squirrel hunt. The pup was still mighty little, but the way I figured it, if he was big enough to act like Old Yeller, he was big enough to start learning to earn his keep. The end. Thanks for joining me for this latest installment of Booked for the Night. Until next time, thanks for listening, and good night.